Well, it's good to see everybody here today. Just a couple of real quick things before I get into the message. I want to remind you this Friday night from 6:30 to 8:30, we have a men's barbecue at the Freeman House. Freeman House have become really dear friends to us. There's probably about 60 guys that come every week. Sometimes you've come here and maybe it's been raining and you see this parade of umbrellas going out the car and helping people in. Those are a lot the Freeman men who just say, hey, it's a courtesy. We can help out, do anything we can to serve. So these are people that are coming off the street. Sometimes they're people that have a prior felony or an arrest or something like that. And the Freeman House gives them a place to stay. They have to contribute to the house. They have to pay their portion in that. But they get back on their feet, and Troy helps them get readjusted to life. So if there's some men that you just like some good fellowship time, have an opportunity to get to know some of these guys, maybe be a friend, be a brother to each and every one. Just show up. We'd love to have you there. There are no kids under 18 that are allowed to come to be a part of this, but if you'd like to be a part of it, please do. I want to introduce you to a friend of mine. This is Lee Gerald. I called Lee a few weeks back and said, Lee, I could really use your help right now. And when Pastor David resigned, you know, we wanted to make sure that those duties, especially that fell under his care, like watching and mentoring our chaplaincy, crisis calls at the church, emergency counseling, funerals, weddings, things like that, we would have somebody to step into that. And I got to tell you, with Lee Gerald, you get a major upgrade over me. And I mean that sincerely from the bottom of my heart. You know, of all the people I've ever known in my life, I've known Lee for, 25 plus years. We've been in community together for 23 years. He's a dear and trusted friend, but I have said to many people, and I've never said this about another man in my life, I said, you know, when I grow up, I want to be like Lee. He's a man that has a real solid walk with Jesus Christ. He's got integrity through and through. What he teaches is what he lives. And I'm just so grateful that he's here. He's been working on a series, a teaching that he's going to do for Springcreek on the Beatitudes as a healing path and movement of our lives deeper and deeper into the heart of God. And that'll be offered sometime, I'm sure, in the coming months, and I know you'll look forward to that. Well, we're continuing our series, Imperfectly Church, and today's message is A Purpose Beyond Our Walls, Loving Those We Find in the Margins. If you will, just bow your heads with me. God, I really believe with all of my heart that we are in a special Kairos moment, a moment that is of your making, a moment that is pregnant with possibility. But what is so important in a time like this is that we lean in and listen to you, that we're hearing your leadership, that we're following in your footsteps, that we're staying lockstep with the Spirit. What I would ask today as I go through what is a very important message, Old and New Testament echo it alike, about who the church is, what we're called to be in this world, that, Lord, you would just have the freedom to speak to all of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Today I want to focus on one particular passage. It's in the book of Micah chapter 6. It's been commonly called the Micah Mandate. To give you an idea of how significant this passage of Scripture has been, even in our history as a country, back in 1917, American troops were all getting prepared to be put on boats and sail across the Atlantic in order to take the battlefields in France and Belgium in World War I. The New York Bible Society arranged that every soldier would carry with them a pocket New Testament. And what they asked is they asked former President Theodore Roosevelt to have a message, to write a message that they would inscribe in the front cover of each and every one of these Bibles. And this is what he wrote. The teaching of the New Testament is foreshadowed in Micah's verse. What doth the Lord require of thee than to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with thy God? He said, it's the Micah mandate. That's what I want you to remember. Our very first president, George Washington, near the end of his career, one of his final speeches, he said this, I now make it my earnest prayer that God would be most graciously pleased to dispose us all to do justice, to love mercy, and to demean ourselves with charity, humility, and pacific temper of mind, which were the characteristics of the divine order of blessed religion. For without a humble imitation and example in these things, we can never hope to be happy as a nation. George Washington, our very first president, said, if we want our nation to be happy, if we really want to know true joy, then we have to follow in the footsteps of the Micah Mandate. In the history of our country, at least a half a dozen presidents, when they were sworn into office, asked the Bible to be opened to Micah chapter 6 so that they could lay their hands on this verse. It was that important. Two of our presidents mentioned this verse in their inaugural addresses. At least three others cited the passage during their terms of office in various speeches given to the country. This also happens to be a verse that is inscribed on at least three buildings or national monuments in our nation's capital. People like Patrick Henry, Samuel Adams, and Clare Luce Booth were all heavily influenced by this verse. All that to say, presidents and patriots and pastors have all recognized that within this single verse is a world of wisdom. And most of all, Jesus Christ himself, who one day in a discussion with the Pharisees, pointing out that they practice obedience in all the little things, but they neglected the more important things, he cited the Micah mandate. He said, woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you've neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. That's the Micah mandate. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former. You might remember last week we were talking about love, how that love is the foundation of everything we do as a church, and that Jesus himself said, when he was asked, what's the greatest commandment? He said, it's this, you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you love your neighbor as yourself. Loving God, loving your neighbor is the motivation behind every commandment God gave in the Old Testament. Well, the Micah mandate is very similar. Jesus called this the weightier or the more important part of the law. In other words, if you want to know the behavior that God was trying to produce in his people through the Old Testament law, it's simply this, that he would have a people who acted justly, who loved mercy, and walked humbly with him. Jesus said, this has been for all time what God has expected of his people. So what is it about this verse that strikes a chord within the hearts of so many great leaders? Well, in the Old Testament, there's this prophet. His name is Micah. He's preaching at what I call the end of the good times. So this is just before Jerusalem is destroyed. The temple is literally dismantled stone by stone, and the wall was completely wiped out. Remember, we just finished Nehemiah, and they were rebuilding the wall? So this is about 100 years prior, and Micah is telling the people it's all about to happen. Now, we don't know a lot about Micah. We know he's from a small rural community about 20 miles south of Jerusalem. We also know that he lived at the same time as Isaiah, but specifically at the same time as Hosea. So the nation of Israel was divided at this time. The northern kingdom was called Israel. The southern kingdom, where Jerusalem was called Judah. Hosea was prophesying in the north. Micah is prophesying in the south. Now, most of the prophetic writings follow the very same pattern. Criticism and accusation followed by promises of hope and healing. And Micah follows the same pattern. The only difference in Micah's book is he goes through that cycle three times. Basically, he says the same thing over and over again. Accusation, hope, accusation, hope, accusation, hope. Now, the message changes very little. But Micah, what he in essence says, is that God hates sin. And no amount of good religious behavior is going to make up for that. He hates the rich, whose only aim in life is to get more stuff. He hates dishonesty. He hates violence, and he hates false prophets who only preach what people want to hear. In fact, the only thing that people want to hear is God is in heaven on his throne, and everything's just fine with the way we do life. In fact, he wrote, this is Micah 2:11, listen to this. If a liar and deceiver comes and says, I will prophesy for you plenty of wine and beer, he would be just the preacher for this people. So they wanted somebody that gets up and says, hey, it's Miller time, right? They want somebody to get up there and say, you know, it's okay, just go out, have a great time. All God cares about is you show up, you bow the knee, you offer the sacrifice, you live the way you want to live. He said that would be the perfect preacher for you. But sadly, judgment's about to fall. And like with every judgment in the Bible, and this is a pattern you can see from Genesis to Revelation. With every judgment that comes from God, first there's a warning, and then there's a telling what specific act of sin is being judged. And third, there's a clear path to avoid the judgment if you do what God says. So if God's going to judge you for something, he's going to send a messenger to tell you. He's going to tell you what it's for, and he's going to tell you what you can do to avoid it. Always, without fail, again and again in Scripture. It's why I hate when people say that hurricanes and earthquakes are the judgment of God. My first question, the moment somebody says that, what prophet announced it? What sin was it against? And what was the way out if people repented? And if you don't have that, you don't have specific divine judgment. That's when, you know, when Katrina happened, there were all kinds of people saying, God's judging New Orleans. And I thought, really? You know, God has bad aim because the French Quarter was totally... because that would seem to be the place you would go after if you're judging somebody. But you know, when people say that kind of stuff, what it really tells you is how they view God. They view God as capricious. They view God as arbitrary, that God just kind of does nilly-willy and you don't know. You may be slapped upside the head and you don't know that's from God. Listen, friends, that's not God. That's not the God of the Bible. That's not the pattern he lays down in Scripture. So judgment's looming on the horizon. And the people decide... before that judgment falls, Israel wants her day in court. They want to be the plaintiff, and they want to put God on trial. So what God does is he says, okay, let's do this. And God gets up on the witness stand, and he calls all the mountains together and said, you're the jury. In other words, the mountain's been around long enough to see some stuff, right? So you're the jury. You listen to what they have to say because they're going to bring accusation. But before they can say anything, God's going to make his point. And as he begins to make his point, there's no question he's flipping roles. Israel's now on trial. There's no innocent until proven guilty in this court. They are unquestionably guilty as charged, and the evidence is overwhelming. So they ask, what do we have to do to set things right? And their answer shows you just how clueless they are. They begin by saying, well, maybe we ought to bow down to God. He likes that sort of stuff. And then they say, well, maybe what we need to do instead of that is we need to bring a year-old calf, not just a newborn, firstborn calf. But a year old, one that's really valuable, one that we really know how it's doing, we'll give that. Oh, maybe that won't be enough for God. Maybe we need to bring thousands of rams and rivers of oil. Maybe the only thing that's going to satisfy this unsatisfied God is for us to give our firstborn kids. And Micah just stands there shaking his head and listening to this pathetic attempt to please God. Israel does not get it. They think religious ritual is what pleases God. They think they can behave any way they want outside the house of God. And as long as they show up and they do their prayers and they bring their offerings and they make their prescribed sacrifices, that God is just kind of under obligation to protect them and bless them. And so Micah says in exasperation, he's shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? In other words, this is not new news. I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. God has already told you what he expects out of you. The path is clear. So Micah stands up at this mock trial, and he asks and answers the question, what does God require? I believe sincerely with all of my heart, the more God wants us to get a lesson, to really get it, to understand it, to live it out, the simpler he makes it. He doesn't make it hard. He puts it on the bottom shelf where everybody can. You know, Ernest Hemingway was once asked about how he approached writing, and this is what he said. All you have to do is write one true sentence. And what he meant by that is, as a writer, if he could write that one true sentence, then everything else would flow out of that one true sentence. So if you look at Micah and his prophecy, and you judge it by that standard, then the one true sentence is what he writes when he says, to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. That's the sentence. It's 14 words. It's small enough to put in a tweet. I think all the characters would be just fine. It's simple. It's profound. It's succinct truth. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with God. That's what is of utmost importance to God. And Jesus, in his ministry, echoed the same thing. He said, Pharisees, yeah, you do your religious rituals. That's great. You ought to do that. But there's something more important, and you do not need to neglect these things: justice, mercy, and faith. These are the things that God expects of all people. So since God expects this of all of us, it's important we understand what he means by acting justly, loving mercy, and walking humbly with him. So let's begin. Acting justly, biblical justice is about the need to reorder our world and set it right. Let me ask you something. I mean, we know sin has infected all individuals, but sin has infected everything individuals has touched as well. That means there's sin in families, right? And in family relationships between husbands and wives. Don't say amen, okay? But you, between husbands and wives, between parents and kids, between families and extended families, between us and our in-laws. I mean, there's sin that gets into all of that. Sin gets into government, doesn't it? Oh, yeah. I mean, I thought a big amen would come after that. Sin gets into government. Sin gets into society. Sin gets into our culture. Now, let me ask you something. What does Jesus want to redeem? Does he just want to redeem individuals? Or does he want to redeem everything that's been touched and infected and affected by sin? He wants to redeem it all. And I happen to believe that the power of the cross and the glorious resurrection of Jesus Christ is powerful to make that change happen. I believe that that's what the gospel is about. It's about redeeming what's been infected and affected by sin. Now, biblical justice is very different from criminal justice. Biblical justice is about setting the world right the way it was meant to be. But that doesn't always happen with criminal justice. I mean, think about it. Somebody may do you an egregious wrong. You might even lose a loved one because of the wrongdoing of somebody else. And you could have your day in court. And they may be found guilty. But does that set everything right in your world? It doesn't. Loss is still there, right? Maybe you lost a loved one to a drunk driver. Maybe it is that, you know, something horrific happened to one of your kids at the hands of somebody who was an evil person. That damage is not undone in that. Well, this Old Testament word justice is mishpat. And mishpat is about restoration, not retribution. So God's not seeking revenge. God is seeking to make people whole, to repair what's broken, to set things right. If your only association with justice is criminal justice, making sure the guilty get caught and go to jail and the innocent are set free, that's just too limited for this Old Testament word. The idea, the big idea behind what God is talking about has less to do with the conviction of the guilty and more to do with the care of the innocent. So justice fundamentally is about fairness. If a society is just, if we're just as a people, it means we treat all people fairly. So an example, the civil rights movement was a struggle for justice because African Americans were denied the right to vote, the right to eat in certain public restaurants, the right to public accommodations, the right to attend the school of their choice. When we deny one segment of society justice, when we treat one aspect of society different than the rest, we don't treat them fairly, that's called a social injustice. So God wants us to be fair. You know why? Because he's fair. God is fair with everyone. You know, the Bible says he sends his rain on the just and the unjust. Why? I mean, if God only watered the lawns of the really good people, all of our lawns would be brown, right? I mean, we'd be in trouble, but God sends his good rains on everybody, regardless of their behavior. The Bible also says about God, God is no respecter of persons. Which means it doesn't matter who you are, how much money you have, who your daddy is, how smart you are. God is fair with everyone. He always will be. Paul Tillich, the theologian, said, justice is the backbone of love. And what he meant by that is you can't really say that you love someone, love them well, love them rightly, if you're not being fair with them. If you're not being fair with them, if you're denying them justice, then you don't really love them. Do you know that there are 9 separate words associated with justice in the Bible? Anytime you see the word justice, usually you'll see these words: widow, fatherless, orphans, poor, hungry, stranger, needy, weak, and oppressed. These are the vulnerable members of society. These are the people in the margins. These are the people most often denied justice and fairness. Now notice what's not in there. You don't see rich in there anywhere, do you? Why? Because the rich can always afford their justice. But the poor, they don't get justice. The people in the margins, they don't get justice. They're not treated fairly. So over and over again in the scripture, we find that society will be judged by how it treats its most vulnerable citizens. This is how you know whether or not a people really believe in justice. It's like Henry Nouwen said, a true disciple of Jesus Christ will always go where people are feeling weak, broken, sick, in pain, poor, lonely, forgotten, anxious, and lost. So God calls us to be a different kind of people. We're a kind of people who not only call for justice in the greater world to make the world right, to set it right with God, but more importantly and more fundamentally, that we practice and live out justice among ourselves. That we are a people that are always fair with everybody. Because you know what? You can't call out society and say, you're not doing this right if we're not doing it right. We've got to be a people who always practice fairness in all of our dealings. So that's what it means biblically to act justly. And God expects it of all of his kids. But he desires more than justice. He wants a people who love mercy. Now the Hebrew word for mercy is chesed. Some people pronounce it hesed. It's a difficult word for us to translate over into one English word because it's bigger than any of our single English words. It's a relationship word. It's the idea of getting inside someone else's skin. William Barclay. He said it like this. Mercy means the ability to get right inside the other person's skin until we can see things with his eyes, think things with his mind, and feel things with his feelings. Have you ever been with somebody who was deeply, profoundly hurting, and the more you listened, the more that hurt just kind of entered into you, and you started seeing life for a minute from their perspective, and you started feeling their pain? And you start feeling real compassion welling up inside you. That's this thing called chesed. Now, the Jews thought this was a very important word because this is one of the words that describes God. God is always merciful to us. And because God is merciful to us, he expects us to be merciful with one another. It's a relationship word, but it means more than just our feelings. It means the willingness to get your hands dirty. You see, you can't really love in this way until you've experienced the love of God. And when the love of God gets inside of you, that love begins to flow out. This word chesed in the Old Testament, the equivalent in the New Testament, is agape love. You ever heard that term before? Chesed, this mercy, is agape love. It's a kind of love that God has for each and every one of us. Now, there's a beautiful example of chesed in the Old Testament, an entire book dedicated to explaining it, and it's called the Book of Ruth. The Book of Ruth is often mischaracterized by many pastors as a romance novel. This is not a romance novel. The word love is never even mentioned in the book. Did you know that? Even though Ruth and Boaz end up becoming husband and wife, the Bible never says Ruth loved Boaz and Boaz loved Ruth. Now, don't get me wrong. It is about love, but it's not romantic love. It's selfless, sacrificial love. It's hesed love. Now, you have to ask yourself, if you don't know this story, you need to read it this afternoon, but those of you that do, ask yourself, why is it that Boaz loved Ruth in this way? A lot of people say, well, it's because she was so beautiful. Well, guess what? The Bible never says she was beautiful. She might have been, she might not have been. It's not about attraction here. It's about something else. And to understand what's really going on, you need to understand something about Boaz's family. You see, in the book of Ruth, chapter 4, verse 21, it tells us that Salmon was Boaz's dad. You say, well, what does that mean to me? Well, probably the same thing it means to me, nothing. But if you go over to the Gospel of Matthew and you start reading the lineage of Christ, what you discover in Matthew 1:5 is Salmon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. You recognize that name? That's the prostitute of Jericho. That's the Canaanite who left her people to become a part of the people of God. That's Boaz's mom. Now this story starts to make sense. You see, Boaz, when he sees Ruth, he sees another enemy of God. She's not an Israelite. She's not a Canaanite. She's a Moabite. These are some of the most detested people in the Old Testament. And Boaz, when he sees her, and he remembers what it was like for his mother to struggle to leave an entire people and unite herself with a new people to become one of the stalwarts, the heroes of the Israeli faith. He looks at Ruth and he remembers his mom. And he loves her in that kind of way, with that kind of mercy. He can enter into that experience because that's what his mom lived out. So mercy begins when your hurt gets in my heart. But it's more than feeling sorry for someone. Really, the best definition of mercy I know is mercy's compassion in action. This is exactly what 1 John 3 is talking about when the Bible says, if someone who's supposed to be a Christian has enough money to live on and sees a brother in need but won't help him, how can God's love be in him? Let's stop just saying we love people. Let's show it by our actions. Mercy's a visible thing. It means I interrupt my schedule and I spend my money. Mercy is seeing somebody who's begging for love and giving them love. Mercy's seeing someone who's lonely and giving them company. Mercy's not just feeling the need, it's about meeting the need. What I'm telling you is mercy's not a spectator sport. It's more than just noticing. It's more than just feeling something inside. It's saying I want to get involved. Now, I don't know about you, but any given day of the week, there are 100 things that pull at my heart's attention that are really worthy of support. You know, tomorrow morning, I'm speaking at Buckner International. I'm speaking in their chapel to their executive staff. I'm looking forward to the opportunity. They're doing amazing work with kids who have been orphaned, with kids who are in the whole process of trying to find homes and moms and dads. I mean, they do incredible work. There are all kinds of things that are worthy of our support, but guess what? God has given you a unique set of gifts and a unique sphere of influence. And more than anything, he wants you to begin right where you are. That's why I love this quote. Listen to this. Ours is not the task of fixing the entire world at once, but of stretching out to mend the part of the world that's within our reach. You know what I've noticed over time? I've noticed that when somebody really gets a passion for something, they really believe, you know, that is it, and everybody ought to be doing what they're doing. Have you ever noticed that? You know, people that get real involved with the homeless, I mean, they believe, you know, homeless ministry is where it's at. I mean, Jesus was homeless. If you're not going to love the homeless, you must not love Jesus. You know what I mean? You get that kind of stuff put on you? I'm glad they love the homeless. I'm glad they're working with the homeless. My heart breaks for the homeless. I believe it's worthy of support. Doesn't mean everybody's called to work with the homeless. There are people who really believe that we need to stand up. We need to walk some picket lines. We need to let the world know what we think about different things. Great, praise the Lord. I'm so glad your heart is so wound up for justice. Doesn't mean everybody's called to do that. You know what I love? I love the fact that God has placed in some people's heart a love for our kids. And every time we're meeting in here as adults, they're loving on babies in the nursery. And they're helping these kids learn about God and that kid's importance in God's life and God in their life. And they're discipling them and helping them to grow up with a real sense of faith and know that they're valued by God. I'm glad for that. I'm glad for the men and women who every week are going to these extended care facilities and these elderly people who many times were forgotten by their own families. They get somebody who shows up and lets them know that they're loved, that they're not forgotten. And this person brings a smile and they bring a song and maybe a goodie in the bag that they're carrying just to let them know that they're important. I'm glad that there are people in this church who believe that God has given them a ministry of hammers and nails and power tools. God certainly passed me over on that one, but I'm so glad that there are people who have that gift because they believe this is their unique calling, their unique sphere of influence, and you give them a project to do, they'll get on it, and they will do it with all their heart. I'm so glad that there are people who love on our people, with our friends with disabilities. They come every week. They care so desperately to know that they are valued. And these people just show up again and again and love on them and let them know that they matter to God. So how about let's all stop judging other people for not doing what we're doing and start thanking God that he made them the way he did and that each and every one of us has a vital role in fulfilling Christ's mission on this earth. Amen? I don't know who this lady is, Verna Dozier. No quote has impacted me like this woman. The important question to ask is not what do you believe, but what difference does it make that you believe? Does the world come nearer to the dream of God because of what you believe? That's the question that mercy is asking. God is not telling you you're responsible for every need in the world. But what he is telling you is I've made you uniquely in my image to carry on my mission in this world. In what way is the world different? And it's approaching the dream of God because you've chosen to exercise your gifting in a way to serve him. And then, of course, the final thing is God wants us not just to act justly, not just to love mercy, but also to walk humbly with him. This means to live in sync with God, to be in tune with God. Live in solidarity with his purpose. Since we have been created in the image of God, it means we carry on the mission of God. Now we're told to walk in humility. What is that? Well, Warren and Ruth Meyer say humility is thinking true, realistic thoughts about God and ourselves. The Bible's chock full of information about who we are. It pulls no punches. We're flawed. We're sinful. We fall short of God in every conceivable way. But on the other hand, it reminds us about the truth that we're valuable and significant to God. We're skillfully and wonderfully made. We've been made into new persons in Christ, completely forgiven and totally accepted. Humility is about understanding both sides of that truth, that though flawed and broken, I'm forgiven and valuable. To walk humbly with God is not just to keep myself in perspective, but to keep him in perspective, who he is. He's my master. He's my Lord, he's my God, he is my friend. You know, many times in Scripture, we're identified in a certain way. Only once are we called in Scripture Christians. You know that? It's in the book of Acts, chapter 6. We're called Christians one time. The rest of the time, we're called servants. That's who we are. We're servants to the Most High. We're here to follow him. We're here to do what he does, to go where he goes, to say what he once said. That's what a servant does. A couple weeks ago, I told you the true story of Clarence Jordan. Clarence Jordan is an amazing man, two doctorates, went to Americus, Georgia back in the 1940s to establish an integrated farm, black families, white families working together at Koinonia Farms. It was an amazing thing, except for the fact that he was opposed. He was opposed by the community, he was opposed by the church and the KKK, and they were often one and the same. And they came out, of course, you know, I told you the story, how they burned the farm and they riddled his home full of bullets. Well, at the height of his troubles, you know, he was getting harassed every time his workers would go into town and they would boycott all of his produce that they were making at the farm. At the height of his troubles, he decided he needed some legal help, and he has a brother who's a lawyer. So he goes to his brother and he says, you know, I really desperately need your help. We've got to get some kind of legal aid on our side because we're just being harassed to the bone. And his brother realized that if he did this, that it would probably cost him being aligned with Koinonia Farms, and he refused to help. So Clarence said to his brother this, brother, you and I walked the aisle of that little Baptist church when we were young. I think you need to go back and clarify what you told the pastor that Sunday morning. You need to tell those people that what you really meant to say was that you admire Jesus, not that you want to follow him. The key to Clarence Jordan's success is he believed God's church is not the Jesus Admiration Society. Instead, we're a band of believers who are bound and determined to do his will no matter what the cost. It's made up of ordinary people who do extraordinary things because they trust an amazing God. We're his servants. We do what he asks. So we act justly. We love mercy. And we walk humbly with him. So what's a healthy, balanced church? A healthy, balanced church is one that does all three. One out of three is not good enough. Two out of three, still not. It takes all three to be a healthy church. You have to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. I told you when I was a kid, I went to Deerfield Village, to where the Henry Ford Museum is outside Detroit. And as a kid, there's a section of that museum that's dedicated to the old steam engines. And one of the steam engines there happens to be one of the largest ones ever built in the world. It's amazing. You know, as a kid, I wasn't even as tall as the smallest wheels on this engine. It was just massive. I mean, it dominates the entire room. And there's all this information about the boiler size and power and all that stuff. But the thing that struck me at the time is that 96% of the power that it generated was used just for the engine itself. And only 4% of its power was used to pull the load. And you know what, as an adult, I look back on that and I think, you know, that's the average church in America. They spend 96%. And actually, the truth is, they spend 97% because the average church in America only spends 3% of its annual budget in the community outside their walls. 97% of the energy, the time, the money is all consumed within the walls. Friends, that's not a church. It's not a church. That's endlessly catering to the self. I am so grateful that I lead a church that even though we had a $2 million budget last year we were able to give away over $500,000. We invested that in the community. We decided to make a difference. We believe that these walls don't define the church. So I just kind of, in this last few moments, I just want to kind of talk to you from the heart about how we see these three things playing out. One is to walk humbly. And I believe with all of my heart that roots are related to fruits. In other words, if we don't send roots deeply into Jesus Christ, we can never sustain the movement outward. We can't have an impact in our world if we're not sending our roots into Christ. I am so grateful that Lee has come on staff to help us out, to make a difference, to invest his life. It's going to be huge. I am so grateful for him, his walk with the Lord. But somebody else who's been a big part of my life, my spiritual director, Carolyn Atkins, she's decided she wants to make Spring Creek her home. She's decided she wants to make a difference as well. Carolyn Atkins, yeah. I mean, many of you know I've talked for years about my community group. These are the two people in my community group. We've met together for 23 years, once a week. It's always been so assuring to me and wonderful for me, and we're going to keep on meeting. And we decided, you know, after 23 years together, we could start working together. And they just want to make a difference. And I can tell you this about Carolyn. You know, I went to Bible college. I went to seminary. I learned all about Jesus. I learned all about studying the Bible. But I learned how to walk with Jesus from Carolyn Atkins. And I am so grateful that she wants to now invest that in our church family. So we want to learn to walk humbly. We're also in this process of beginning our search. In fact, I've even started to talk to our first candidate about this potential opportunity for an associate pastor of discipleship. One of the things we began to realize is that we really have to, as a church, built into our church family. Our adults especially need to know that there are ways to connect and ways that they can be discipled and ways that they can grow in Christ. So we are looking for somebody who has Bible college and seminary experience, because we have been at a deficit in that area, and it's been costly because our people can only grow to the level that their pastors are at. And so we're looking for people with experience and a proven track record who can come in here and help us to be able to grow and send our roots deep into Christ. We want to walk humbly with him. We also want to love mercy. And so mercy is all about looking in your world and asking what a difference you can make. I'm glad the students did the big ask. I'm really glad that they did that, and I'm glad because there are so many of you who are gifted with young people. From the cradle to the grave, you're a magnet for a certain type of kid. And you know what? It would be wonderful if you would let God use those natural inborn giftings that you have, those inclinations, and start using them for the kingdom of God. And start investing in people. So when you see somebody out in the lobby that has one of these t-shirts on, say, hey, you know, I'd like to explore this. Nobody's going to get you committed for the rest of your life, sign in blood. We wait till the second week to do that. We want you to come in and check it out, try it out, but get involved, make a difference. Mercy's not just a spectator of event. It is one of those things that we see a need and we get involved in the need. So whatever that may be, may God use you in that area, but then justice. And I tell you, this has been on my heart forever. I believe with all of my heart that if you just protest injustice, but you don't provide the alternative, then I think it's just a bunch of words. I think that the church has an obligation to live out justice and to do fairness and to practice things that the world will never do, because we have the motivation of the love of Jesus Christ in our midst. So one of the things that happened, and the people who have been at the business meeting knows about this, but the rest of the church doesn't. Last year, we decided, because of something my associate pastor, Gary Owen, he's our executive pastor here, he went to a pastor's conference. And this church had a daycare that was profitable. First, that's a huge exception. That just never happens in church, but it was a profitable daycare. But what they noticed is when parents were coming and dropping off their kids in the morning, they had this pile of dirty clothes in the back seat because they were going from there to the dry cleaners. And they said, hey, what if we became a one-stop shop so that you drop off your kids and right next door is the dry cleaners? And we operated that business and we started helping people to get their clothes dry cleaned. And it worked. And then they noticed when parents were coming to pick up their kids, sometimes at 6, 6:30, and 7, they were going by McDonald's for a nice nutritious meal, and they said, hey, can we provide an alternative to that? And they decided to start a business of prepared meals. And so people were dropping off their dry cleaning and picking up these prepared meals, and it was going so great that these enterprises generated an additional $2 million a year that the church could use for outside causes. You know, the thing about it is the people that are here in this church, you support Springcreek. We don't need outside money to support Springcreek, but it sure would be great to have money to support other kingdom enterprises, because we can give and we're going to keep on giving, but what if we could grow that part of our church? But what if in the process we could create new systems of justice? You know, we are blessed to have this relationship with the Freeman House. About 60 guys every week come. And some of them are coming off the street. Some of them are coming, they've been in prison before, they even have a felony. If you know anything about people with a record in our country, you know that when you go to apply for public assistance and you check the box felon, you're not getting public assistance. And you know that if you go to a place to rent an apartment and you say, I got a felony, there's no apartment for you. And you know, if you go and try to find a job, in many applications, there's some information about your background, and you mark felon, you're probably not going to get a job either. So we won't give them a place to live, we won't help them, we won't let them find a job, and guess what they do? They reoffend, they go back into the system because that's the only place they can go. So what if we started businesses that gave people like that and others and single moms and different ones that maybe have trouble finding traditional employment, what if we created new opportunities for them? What if we found ways for them to meaningfully give back, paid them a decent, livable wage, and still generated money that could be used for the kingdom of God? What if we did that kind of ministry? You know, I was in Charlotte, North Carolina, just about a month ago. And while I was there, I had the privilege of sitting down to lunch with Leighton Ford. I don't know if you know his name or not, Leighton Ford was a longtime associate of Billy Graham. When they would do these crusades all around the world, Leighton Ford would often be there for the first 3 or 4 days, and he'd be doing the preaching and all the preparation work, and he'd be leading the crusade, and then Billy Graham came in as the closer. So the last couple of nights, Billy Graham would be there, but Leighton Ford was laying the groundwork. So Leighton is married to Billy Graham's sister, and really a wonderful man that has changed the world in all kinds of ways, and I had the privilege of having lunch with him. So I'm sitting at this really nice little diner called Rooster's. If you're ever in Charlotte, go check out this place. I had lasagna. It was to die for, the best lasagna I've ever had. And while we're sitting there, he says, "You realize that everybody who's employed here has been in prison." I said, "You're kidding me." He said, "No." He said, "Yeah, this pastor got this vision of starting a ministry and starting restaurants and employing people like that. In fact, he started a dream center downtown, and they have a restaurant downtown that actually employs more people and even produces more profit than this restaurant." He said, "It'd be so great if you could meet that pastor, especially with your own heart, because we're talking about issues like this." And guess who walked in the restaurant? It was that pastor and the owner. And Leighton said, "Hey, come over here." And he introduced us and said, "This pastor thinks like you do." And so the guy says, "Hey, anytime you want to bring a team to Charlotte, I'll take you down to the Dream Center, show you around, show you what we're doing, how we're doing it." He said, "The main thing for me as a church is I want to keep this centered on Jesus." He says, "So every time and every day, you know, we have a time of devotions with our staff. We talk about Christ and the difference that he makes in our life." And I thought, wow, this is amazing. So we're going ahead with this. I don't know exactly what it may look like or what business might be for our future, but we got our 501c. It just came and it was approved about 3 weeks ago, so that we can begin to help our business leaders make a real difference around here. You know, one of the most insulting things that we do with CEOs and people who are business owners and people who've been able to actually produce tremendous income, they come to the church, we have nothing else to do, and say, "Well, you know, you could be a greeter, you know," and there's nothing wrong with being a greeter. I mean, greeting is a really important thing. But you know, when they have this amazing skill set of knowing how to build a business from scratch and knowing how to produce money for the kingdom of God and know how to do employment the right kind of way, and we say, "Hey, could you assist us in this dream that we have of being a church that's creating new fairness, a church that really does act justly?" So I hope you'll be in prayer for all that. There's so much more I could tell you about. There's all kinds of new avenues opening up for us internationally and influence and possibilities. But pray for your church in these days. I believe with all of my heart that we're meant to be a church beyond these walls. And I believe that the church that God will bless is a church that acts justly, that loves mercy, and walks humbly with him. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your incredible love. Thank you, God, that what you expect of us, you made crystal clear. And Jesus reiterated to the Pharisees, "You've forgotten the most important part: justice, mercy, faith." It's that simple. It's what the law was aiming at all along. This is what love looks like in relationship. We act out on justice, we love, and we cherish mercy and getting inside of people's skin. And above all, God, we walk humbly with you, knowing that you're the source of life and you're the source of love. So God, as a church, help us to stay in lockstep with you and help us to trust you for the future and all the results. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.